Okay, welcome back everyone.
This is
today our last panel session of this afternoon
before we go into the keynote.
In this panel, we'd like to talk about security from sexual violence, and we'll try to examine how to protect individuals and what kind of instruments we have to do so. So we have, an expert panel here with us. So I'm really pleased to introduce to you, left from me, Susan Aref from the Women Empowerment Organization in Iraq. Next to Susan, we have Colonel Burama Diop from the Center for Change and Conflict Management in Senegal. We have Dr. Carol Cohn from the Consortium on Gender, Security and Human Rights in Boston. And we have Ambassador Liberata Mulla Mulla from the Office of the President of Tanzania, in Tanzania. And we'll have coming, joining us in a second, Gina Torrey from Peace Research Institute in Norway. There she is, Gina Torrey from PRIO. Will, Chantal, you've met us both by now, so we'll moderate, facilitate this panel. Let me ask Ambassador Mulla Mulla first. You've been closely involved in the Great Lakes region, and we've heard various comments already on the region, but you were the first Executive Secretary General of the International Conference of the Great Lakes, and there's a number of regional instruments that have been adopted that specifically address the issue of sexual violence, including the Kampala Declaration. So I wanted to ask you if you could comment a little bit what these instruments mean for the region, how we can evaluate these instruments.
Thank you very much. Let me start this with the diplomatic niceties to thank the U.S. Institute of Peace and the organizers of this important global symposium. For me, I must say it is a defining moment to be here because, as you rightly said, Kelly, I've been involved in the search for solutions to our endemic problem of the sexual violence in the Great Lakes region. I was privileged to have headed this international conference on the Great Lakes region. It sounds like a conference. It's not a conference as a meeting. It is an institutional mechanism. It's a regional organization that was established as a response to the cyclic conflicts that have bedeviled our region. Since the last 2 days I've been here, references have been made in one or another to the countries of the region. The DRC, Uganda, Central African Republic, you name it. So I was given the task by the heads of state to establish this institution. I remember from the presentation that have been made here, you have touched on a number of issues, including the factors that have led to this perpetual problem of the sexual violence, and one of which, and which this is where the region realized what was lacking. One was the institution. Two, the legal framework. I know we heard from Veronica, and she made my work quite easy, that we have very beautiful laws. We have very beautiful reading legal instruments. But I must say what made this initiative of the Great Lakes region unique. For the first time in the history of the continent and even the world, I don't know if there's any region in the world that has a legally binding instrument to fight against sexual violence. This was a milestone. It was adopted in 2006, at the highest political levels, the heads of state of the region committed themselves that in trying to find a lasting peace and stability in the region, they could not ignore this endemic problem of sexual violence. And when I always speak to this kind of audience, given the statistics that is always, you see, as make headline news. For example, you can't miss every time you open a newspaper, you find this is staggering statistics of 5,000 women in DRC have been raped. So when I speak, sometimes people, they say, she speaks with a passion, is she a victim? But this is when our region, in fact, this was supposed to be a regional approach, a regional owned problem, but regional owned solution. And it included, to reach to these instruments you have mentioned, it included all sectors of the society. Mm-hmm. It included the women, the men, the youth, the civil society, but more importantly, to include the political level, highest political level. So since these instruments were established or signed, it was found that there have been signing so many instruments of this nature, but who follows up? Who monitors? Who holds this country's mm-hmm. state parties to account? And this is why they put this institutional mechanism and gave me the mandate, which was threefold. One, to coordinate. Two, to be able to monitor, but also facilitate. So my biggest task was a watchdog, right, to call them to task. And since this instrument was signed, then we had the culmination of the summit dedicated to this issue, where you had the presidents for the first time, those who have attended our summits, there were no prepared texts. Mm-hmm. They were all speaking from the heart. You talked of the shame and naming. Some of the leaders were feeling ashamed that right. they were called upon to speak on this issue. So this is then where I'm saying a lot has been said about whether instruments work, but what gave me satisfaction is to get the commitment to deal with this problem at that highest level.
Right. Since we're talking about instruments, I'd like to ask actually Gina Torrey to talk a little bit about the fact that sexual violence is actually hardly ever mentioned in ceasefire agreements or peace agreements. Why is that so, and what's the consequence of this?
Yeah, thank you very much, and thank you very much for having me here on this panel. It's a good question, and in 2009, there was a meeting convened of high-level mediators and mediation experts to talk about that exact question. Why is it that inside of most peace processes, most ceasefire and peace agreements, have the word sexual violence never appeared? And, you know, what have these mediators and mediation experts done about it? And so over a three-day conference, the conclusion was that, in fact, nobody around the table could actually say that in their mediation experience they had brought this to the table or addressed it, which meant that if you look at most ceasefire and peace agreements that exist to date, sexual violence is not addressed. So it took me about a year, but we produced, the Department of Political Affairs Mediation Support Unit produce guidance for mediators on addressing sexual violence and ceasefire and peace agreements. And this guidance came out of that conference. But it took a lot of research to try to look for just those words, sexual violence. And in the history of ceasefire agreements, up until about a month ago, only three ceasefire agreements ever listed sexual violence inside of the definition of ceasefire. So a definition of ceasefire is are all the things that would breach the ceasefire. So in the case of the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Lusaka Agreement has sexual violence listed inside of the definition of ceasefire. However, it was never monitored for. So having sexual violence inside of the definition is one start, but then it needs to be monitored for. So there's a question about how you think about addressing sexual violence from the beginning of the mediation process to signing a ceasefire agreement, and then to figuring out what are the different kinds of components that need to be inside of agreements for there to be follow-up and implementation. And one of the, and I won't go into great detail about the guidance, but a couple of the key points that have come out of this guidance, we had to produce guidance for practice that quite frankly doesn't exist. So we were challenged. So we spent a long time interviewing mediators, mediation experts, not about how they address sexual violence, but some of their mediation techniques and tricks. And so we've based the guidance off of that. But one of the key concepts that's come from this guidance is that, you know, most peace agreements and all peace agreements and all ceasefire agreements make rules for weapons. They make rules for guns. They make rules for tanks and, you know, all kinds of things. But they don't make rules for methods and tactics of conflict, which sexual violence is. And if you don't make a rule for this, it can go on outside of ceasefire and peace agreements without it being monitored for and without any kind of effective follow-up. And the other main point, one of the main points coming from the guidance, is the fact that preventing sexual violence inside of agreements has a lot to do with command responsibility and ensuring that when you are writing provisions relating to security arrangements inside of these agreements, that you are building in components that would address this kind of violence. And so that's kind of a brief brief overview.
That's great. Thank you. Colonel, you look at this issue from a human security framework, I understand. Could you explain to us a little bit in how far human security might be useful as a framework to approach sexual and gender-based violence?
Thank you very much. I would like to thank USIP for having me here. I'm very honored to be the only man of this wonderful panel. And so thank you for your question. My organization is working in countries that are not post-conflict countries, such as Guinea, but are countries that have the same characteristics as countries that are post-conflict. And our rationale, the rationale behind our work, is that for us, gender-based violence, sexual violence, is a human rights issue. It is a human security issue. And you all know that human security issues have this particularity of being very complex issues, very ambiguous issues. And also, we have noticed that recently, the magnitude is getting bigger and bigger. So one actor alone cannot address human security issues. We need to have a holistic approach. That's what we're trying to do, to have government people, uniformed people, and civil society work together to address efficiently these issues. But we have learned that at the national level, although we need to focus on national dynamics, approaches, we have noticed that they are slow. The governments are heavy machines. They're very important because they define the strategies. They vote the laws, they give the budget, they give the money, but they're slow. And people can get very quickly, very frustrated about what government is doing. So we, in our organization, considered that it was very, very important to also complement the work that is being done at the national level, at the local level, with the same collaborative approach. So at the local level, we have local government, local community-based organizations, local uniformed people work together to identify the human security issues. If it is about sexual violence, yes, it's going to be their number one priority. And they try to see how together they can address these issues. We have also noticed that beyond being a local issue, at least in West Africa, it's a transnational issue. So, and there is no mechanism that facilitates the best practices exchange between countries. Sometimes there are very good experiences going on in the neighboring countries, and we're not aware. So we're trying to facilitate this best practices exchange. And all our work is centered on women, because it did not take us too long to notice that in this region, the future is in the hands of women. They're agents of peace. They're the ones who have stood up when things were very bad to make sure that the society is not falling apart. So in my opinion, and I feel very strongly about that, there is nothing we can do in this region if women is not at the heart of this work. Youth also need to be included, because they're more than 70% sometimes, between 16 to 35. We cannot ignore this part of the society. And the last element we always discuss with our people is that after 50 years of independence, it is really about time for us in Africa to start taking responsibility. We cannot keep waiting for people to come and do things on our behalf. What can we do as Africans? What can we do about this sexual violence? Homegrown solutions that do not require people to come from overseas and give us the resources. I will keep it there for the moment, and thank you very much.
Thank you. That's great. Thank you very much. There's much to discuss, I'm sure. Susan Arif, what are the main challenges to women's security in Iraq?
Yes,
just a couple.
Maybe I have to speak till tomorrow. First of all, I'm very pleased to be here, and thank you for USIP to invite me, and thanks for the conference organizer. And also, I have to say, please forgive me for my English language. I learned very late. So please forgive me if there is any mistake, few or many mistakes. like what challenges that Iraqi women facing in regard to security and protection? Iraqi women have had shared a large marginalized due to all the war and conflict experienced by Iraq. Widowhood, poverty, rape, kidnapping, refugees, IDPs. So this is all affected on women very badly. And if we are talking about what kind of security and protection provided for Iraqi women, we can say on the state level that the various Iraqi law dealing with the crimes of murder and domestic violence and rape call for less penalties or alternative sanction or non-punishment, especially when the victim is woman. So for example, in cases of rape, the Article 398 of the Iraqi Penal Code number 111 indicate that all criminal charges against the perpetrator could be dropped legally if he marries his victim. And sometimes the survived family demands such marriages for the purpose of family honor. If the survived girl refused to marry her rapist, her family asked the judge to intervene and impose marriages. But we can say that this is like, I came from north of Iraq, from Kurdistan. So we are depending on same law. We have the personal status law and criminal law. But in Kurdistan, with many amendments on the same law, that we in 2002 in Kurdistan, they amend this law, and there is no less penalty for this kind of crime. But unfortunately, again, there is no any action, implementation of law. still the mindset, it is the same. The mentality cannot accept the new law. So this is the problem for all Iraq. Even we have new laws, but again, it doesn't work. So this is our problem. So this is on lost level. Even with there's no any kind of support, sheltering for women. Because as I said, if girls refuse to marry with her rapist, so what will be the result? The family, they have to kill her. This is the last solution. So this is why it is very important to have shelters for women, to support them, to provide some like health support, some like psychosocial support. But even in Iraq, they prevent to have such shelters for women because they saying this is serving a bad woman. But in Kurdistan, it is different. We have three shelters in three provinces belong to government, but it look like a prison, not shelter. And this is why women, they have to stay there as prisoners, and they cannot stay for more than 1 year or two years. And this is why they decide to come out, and this will be the end of them to be killed because the family or the community cannot forget about the rape. So this is big problems that women suffering from it. And even for women, they don't have moral support. Yesterday, we talked about name shame. I can add it another word to it, name shamed and blamed. All the community, family, community, even with governmental institution, police officers, or court, they blaming women. All the wrong things, it came from women's side. So this is a big problem. Women in this situation need some support, some moral support, but we don't have any kind of this services. This is what we are trying to do as organization, but we cannot cover all Iraq. It is very big. We based in one provinces, and we can provide it this kind of like services for a group of women. So when perpetrators of sexual violence go unpunished, efforts to establish faith in states' ability to protect its citizens and establish the rule of law, it is seriously undermined. So this is a big problem, how we women can feel she's in a safe place, in a safe country. This is the problem that women cannot trust the community and even with government, no one behind her. Even when we have our listening center and we have our legal help desk inside investigation court and also another one in very conservative area. When women came and they are talking about their problem and we say, okay, we are helping you and you can have your right, you reach your right through, we have to apply your case in police or court. They say, no, please, we don't want to go to police or court because there's no any trust. And the problem, it become worse if they go to police or court. So this is the problem that women facing in Iraq in regard to sexual violence. And it's also, till now, it's taboo. When we are talking about this kind of things with stakeholders, they say, please, no, you don't have to talk about this kind of things. We are in very conservative country, and we are Muslim. We don't have such a problem here. Please don't try to bring a Western problems inside our society. And this is another problem that we cannot talk like loudly about this kind of issue. So if we are not talk about it, how we can solve it? If we are not identifying, not appointing the problem, how we can solve it? Who is helping us?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Carol,
put on your political scientist hat. This panel is about protection and security from sexual violence. Give us a little bit of sense. We've talked a lot about instruments and institutions. What role do they play in this particular regard? And then maybe I also would like, you probably have a comment on Colonel Diop's remark that women are agents of peace. And I'm sure people here in the audience will have as well. So please, Carol.
I think I'll save that until a little bit later.
Okay.
And instead join with him in thinking about transnationalism and transnational issues, not only in terms of response to sexual violence, but actually transnational dynamics, processes, and institutions that are part of causing sexual violence. And I think, you know, we all agree at this point that you really can't eradicate sexual violence without understanding its root causes, that looking at its root causes requires both very specific local contextual examination of gender relations and how they have been transformed by histories of colonialism, of decolonization, and so on. I think we also need to be looking actually at the transnational historical, political, and economic processes that don't only create specific kinds of gender relations, but specific kinds of wars as well. And so what I'd really like to do is bring war back in the room and the processes that, in a certain sense, and the processes that create those wars. And this is, I'm going to say some things that I think all of us are aware of, but then to try to put them in the room to ask what they have to do with sexual violence. We all know that war's dynamics are not only local, but also national, regional, and global in scope. It's been obvious in sort of every example that we've been talking about here. The economic, and just to describe something that's characteristic of many wars now, although not all, the economic, social, and political distortions that have been produced by colonial histories, by the magnification of destruction that was caused when local conflicts were taken up as proxy wars during the Cold War, and the ravages of neoliberal economic policies imposed by international financial institutions have together combined to leave legacies of poverty, inequality, violence, exploitation, minimal to non-existent social support, and weak states rife with corrupt actors. The globalization of capitalist production, trade, and finances leave many countries without the power to regulate their own economies, with ever-increasing gaps between the rich and poor, and whole sectors of the population who are seemingly permanently without the possibility of supporting themselves and their families. Which means that it leaves men with few livelihood options or even means of survival except through joining state militaries and non-state armed groups, which in turn promote and rely on specific and violent misogynist masculinities. Not necessarily the ones they would choose, but the ones that are left to them. These processes also leave much of the country's wealth in the hands of transnational corporations who work with local client elites to ensure stability, not security. And in fact, we know that stability requires ever higher levels of repression and militarization. And so globalization of economic processes and militarization go hand in glove. In this situation, insurgent groups which are seeking social transformation of whatever kind tend to go to fund their activities now that sort of Cold War support is no longer available through development of shadow economies, relying on the control and exploitation of resources such as timber, minerals, gold, diamonds, and so on. And getting back to sexual violence, that requires access to land. What's one of the cheapest ways of clearing land? Spreading terror through sexual violence and other forms of torture and extreme violence. So, to take this down to a very concrete level and to talk again about the DRC on this panel, you take an extremely tiny part of this, the mining of coltan, a mineral used in cell phones, laptop computers, and other electronic devices. There's lots of coltan in the room. It has been one of the many sources of funding for and profit from the war in the Congo. And a UN report from 2001 talked about the illegal exploitation of natural resources and other forms of wealth in the DRC by Rwanda, Uganda, and their proxy militias as the primary exploiters of the DRC's coltan. Both of those governments, along with six of the nine other governments involved in the war in the DRC, have been supported by US military aid in the form of weapons transfers and military training. And China and France have also been big, the two biggest other arms dealers to the region. But it also requires not just militaries, but buyers, right? And who buys coltan? This is multinational corporations who the UN, who this report talks about as the engines of the conflict. They're US-based, they're Europe-based, and they're Asia-based. And then, not only do they buy it, but then they sell it to manufacturers who are, again, based in all of those countries. So my point for the moment is that if you think about the masculinities that are involved in rape in the DRC, we're sort of trained by the media to have a very particular of young, violent, out of control African men, when in fact the masculinities that make rape in the DRC possible include the masculinities of those men who are at the front of those corporations and who work in those corporations and who find it fine to think that they can be very loving to their own children and separate that from their masculinities at work, which are all about abstraction, about seeing manliness as being linked to how much of a profit can you make, and to not thinking about the individuals in the countries that you're exploiting resources from. So if you talk about take it on for yourself, African solutions for African problems, we need to look at these European, American, and Asian masculinities that are also part of these problems through these transnational economic and political processes.
Okay, great. I think we want to take it back to the room here and engage our audience. I also want to go back to the security and the protection side of this issue, and maybe some of you in the audience will do that. So please introduce yourself and have a brief question. Mia.
Mia Bloom, Penn State University. I have a question for Ms. Aref. Under the regime of Saddam Hussein during the Anfal, there's allegations that Kurdish women specifically were targeted, not as the regular rape that you described, but during the course of conflict, specifically because they were Kurdish. And in fact, there are documents in the vaults here, with the ik here, that say Saddam had designated people that their official job was to rape Kurdish women. Is this something that continues to reverberate in the community? Is this an allegation that has been proven untrue? And can you contrast the Kurdish experience with the, let's say, Sunni, like the cross-ethnic experiences, where you don't have the option to marry the rapist if the rapist is a Shia raping a Sunni or someone from another community?
Okay, thank you. Sabrina, here in the yellow.
My name is Sabrina. I'm from Emory University. I have a very specific question for the colonel and then a general question, if that's okay. I'll make it very quick. For the colonel, I know that Senegal has a national action plan for 1325, but the country's been a little bit slow in terms of sending troops female troops into peacekeeping. So I'm wondering why you might be able to explain that the dichotomy. So Ghana, for example, it's the opposite, where they're very good at sending female peacekeepers, but they've never signed a national action plan. So I'm wondering if you could answer that question. And then more generally, my research looks at women's integration into the security sector reform. And just really quickly, I found in Liberia that the integration of the more exposure that community members have with women in the security sector, the less likely the community is to use the security sector. And so this goes into kind of what we were talking about. Carol, you'll probably get into this, the idea of women as peacemaker. And also, I know, Gina, that there's been an increase in the number of female mediators. So I'm curious to know what your thoughts, everyone on the panel, in terms of having more women in the security sector as a response to these problems.
Okay, and then here in the back, the woman with her hand up.
Thank you. Yes, my name's Cornelia Weiss. I'm a member of the U.S. military, and I have a question for the colonel. How do you all select, train, so that your military members are not violators, but they actually provide security from sexual violence? And does your mission or missions, do they include security for sexual violence? And how does that actually take place? So I want the very specifics on how you do that. Thank you.
Shall we go to the panel? Biram. Colonel
yes.
Jobs, why don't you start us off? Since,
I was busy writing the questions. So thank you very much for the questions. Yeah, Senegal does have a national action plan. Even if we had it a little bit late, I think our action plan was written in 2010. During the 10th anniversary of the 1325. And now why, on the one hand, we have a national action plan, and on the other hand, we are not sending females military in peacekeeping mission? It's just because in Senegal, for maybe 50 years, we did not have women in the military. We started recruiting women in the military in 2008, because our society did not consider as proper to have women in the society, in the military. So we are starting slowly to recruit women in the military. We have a quite big number of medicine doctors who are women. We are deploying already in peacekeeping missions, but the first group of women who joined the security sector in general, and the military in particular, came in 2008. So they're still really a small, marginalized group we have. But we are sending them. They're not many, but we are sending them. But we want to make sure that the ones we are sending are ready to do the mission they're supposed to do, just like men who are being deployed next to them. And now, how more women in the security sector, to me, it is a wonderful response to sexual violence. Not only it will help to fight the macho culture of the military, but also the special committee of the UN, who published a report not a long time ago on sexual violence, said clearly that it helps reduce the risk of troops undertaking sexual violence activities. So it's a response, no doubt about that. How we select and train so we don't violate, we don't rape. Senegal has understood since the early years of independence that military need to be professional for them to behave the proper way. So the recruitment we do is not based on ethnic groups, is not based on relationship with the president or the regime in power. It is exclusively based on merit. We set criteria, and those who fulfill the criteria are the ones we recruit. And we are recruiting people who are enough educated to understand this difficulty of the mission that is given to the military. We are even very often accused of being elitist because we recruit generally the best of its generation in our military. In Senegal, the military is not the place where people who have failed in the civilian world are going to hide. No. People who are going to the military are people who had other choices, but who decided to go to the military. That's the way we recruit. But we also train with the means we have. We don't have a particularly big military. We have the military we think we need to protect our country. So we have resources that are enough to put them in good working conditions and in good social conditions. Now, how do we make sure that we have the right measures that prevent sexual violence to happen? We not only capacitate our people in all categories, we train them on specific programs for them to understand that this is not acceptable. First, we hold people responsible when they do make the mistake to undertake such actions. And we also make sure that women are, even if they're a small group, are also part of that. Women are in the security sector, but they have also the responsibility to hold accountable the men who are working next to them when these men are doing things that are not acceptable. Mm-hmm. So all these are the measures we have taken so far. The Senegalese military is known as being a military that respects human rights. Before coming here, I went to the UN office in charge of human rights in Senegal, and I talked to the regional director, and I told him, we want to do our work as military in Senegal without violating people's rights. We would like you to come and capacitate us. And now we have started a program that will last 2 years to empower our people.
Thank you very much. That's great. Susan, would you like to comment?
Yes, of course. Regarding my question, yes, in Saddam time, yes, the Anfal, they killed all like men in Halabja city and raped the women, and they sold women to neighbor countries like Kuwait, Egypt, Jordan, and used them for prostitution. And again, this happened for Iraqi women after 2003. There is a report from Monitoring NAID of Human Rights in Iraq claimed in November 2005 that report confirmed that 2,000 women were raped by occupation troops. And the same source claimed 500 rapes against Iraqi children. So that was in 2005. Now we are in 2013. And of course, what will be the result of all the raped women? So this is very conservative community. And this is the problem that many, we can see that trafficking also raised in Iraq, because mostly women become a widow and they are headed household and they want just to find job opportunities. So those group, they are promising for jobs in Syria or in Jordan, in Egypt. So they are selling them without knowing, and then they taking their passport and they have to work in prostitution. So this is again happened in Iraq.
Thank you, Susan. Would either of you, Gina, would you want to say very briefly a word about the number of female mediators and whether that has made a difference?
And then we'll go back to the audience.
And the question was, has there been an increase in female mediators? And I think you might be surprised to hear that there has never been a lead female mediator appointed in a UN peace process, which is something that the Department of Political Affairs is actively trying to work on. But not to say that women haven't been in mediation roles. Oftentimes in the UN system, people who lead our field missions, they're called special representatives, the Secretary General. There have been several female SRSGs, as we call them, and for instance, there is a very powerful and influential SRSG in the Central African Republic called Margaret Vogt, who's been a big supporter of the Women, Peace, and Security agenda. And you know, just recently, over the last month, she helped to negotiate a ceasefire, a peace agreement that stopped 5,000 rebels from entering the capital city. So women are inside of mediation roles. just that there hasn't been somebody at a very high level, like, for instance, Mr. Brahimi, who's mediating the Syria crisis. But we're working on it.
Okay, we'll go back to the audience, and you've actually picked up by signaling to me. So I actually have quite a list of people. In the back, Ozzy.
Bruce Oswald, USIP and Melbourne Law School. Does the panel have any experience of militias actually stopping sexual violence?
Thank you. Thank you also for the briefness of your question, Ambassador Fadel.
Thank you. Pernille Kartel, I'm with the Danish Foreign Service. And I have two questions for you, Gina. If you can shed some more light on why it has been so hard to get sexual violence into the mediation process from the discussions you were mentioning, and what happens to the mediation processes, how are they different when it then is successful to bring the issue into the mediation processes? And the second issue is around post-conflict protection. We know that, you know, right after a conflict stops, very often it's the women and the women's normalization of life that brings the little communities back to normalcy to some extent, and brings economic development on track. And what is really core for that is public space protection, so that you can go to the market without being raped, et cetera, et cetera. And again, I think we look at these issues of post-conflict protection and wonder why it is so hard to get the very basic post-conflict protection for the public spaces to be so high on the agenda as I think it deserves if you look at if we want to create normalcy. Thank you.
Can you give it to the young gentleman
behind? Hi, my name is Ali Okowat. I'm a physician and GBV researcher from McGill University. Colonel Diop, you mentioned that human security is something that one actor alone cannot tackle, and I wanted to take that statement very literally and ask the panel a question on crisis mapping and its role in GBV. Emerging from the 2007-2008 post-election violence in Kenya, the Ushahidi platform came, and we saw it was used very effectively in Haiti, and we've also seen it used in recent disasters. I'm curious to know, what do you think the potential and limitations are for using crisis mapping as it pertains to GBV and conflict settings? Thank you.
We go to the woman in the back, all the way.
Hi, Millie Lake from the University of Washington. My question is for Carol, and I just wanted to thank you for drawing our attention to global supply chain issues, which I'm surprised that we actually haven't gotten to before now. I wondered if you could say something about what you perceive the incentives are for not just corporations, but also for individual consumers and for foreign governments for actually putting an end to conflict in certain resource-rich areas. And whether you think that there are incentives to keep situations volatile, to keep illegal mineral extraction possible, and what the implications of this are for sexual violence. And just very quickly, if you could also talk about the gendered dynamic. You talked about the masculinities of executive directors of corporations, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the gendered dynamic of that and the extent to which it's a problem of gender and masculinity rather than a problem endemic to global capitalism. Thank you.
And then one last question here, Sanam, and then we go back to the panel. Question or comment?
Thank you very much. I wanted to pick up on the last comment. I'm Sanam Mandralini with International Civil Society Action Network. And to me, I mean, the connection, of course, between what's happening to the women in Congo and all the way up to the corporations is something that we've all known for a long time. But I feel as if, maybe it's because I'm an advocate in civil society, I feel as if it's, you know, this gives us huge opportunity to do something about it. All of us have a cell phone. I mean, why don't we have a campaign that says something about, that targets the companies? Because I'm not sure that I want to think that every single corporate person in the telecommunications industry, and I have many relatives who are in them, is part of this conspiracy. I think that it's actually a lack of knowledge and a lack of connectivity around these issues. We operate in parallel universes in the discussions that we have around these, even here. You know, I mean, the peace and security sector is not here. So maybe part of this is that how should we be using social media? And the folks in the room who are in the world of advertising and, you know, PR, how do we get that story out and try and bring that accountability or awareness to the corporations? That's one thing. The other thing is that a few years ago at the UN level, the people in the Department of Disarmament Affairs were saying, why don't we convene the governments and get them to come to some sort of agreement around how they want to divide the use, you know, their percentage of what resources they take, to take some proactive action with the member states that we're aware of. So there are ways that we could be dealing with this. It's just thinking maybe outside the box or just being, you know, doing it, actually, which is how we got to this agenda in the first place. We didn't wait for anyone else to do it for us. We just did it. So I just think that as depressing as it is, I feel like there's huge creative potential to do something, and it would be great if out of this conference something like that came out for Colombia, for DRC, for other countries where we're seeing extractive industries and sexual violence. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks. This is a great set of very big questions. So I'm not sure if we can do that in less than 45 minutes. Carol, give it a go.
Well, I'm going to try to speak to that and women as peacemakers and women in the security sector all at once. And the way I'm going to try to do that is to say that that I think it's two critical things to think about in relation to gender. One of them is that gender, as we know, is not just a set of ideas about what men and women are like, but a division of, it's a way society is organized, and that means divisions of labor, it means divisions of rights, it means access to resources, it means what you do in your daily life and what your roles are and responsibilities are. And when you take those things on, you don't do it as part of a conspiracy. You don't even necessarily do it as something where you're conscious of taking power, not having power, and so on, but it's kind of what you do. And so if you, and as we know, women's roles and responsibilities have often included, you know, women clean up men's messes, the classic, which is what it's really hard not to keep on hearing when I hear women as peacemakers and women in security sector reform, I have to say. But one thing that means is that we all have within us this huge potential of masculinities and femininities, and what determines what we enact in part depends on those roles and responsibilities, and in part it depends on the gendered institutions within which we participate. And by gendered institutions, I mean specifically not only that all institutions have unequal gender relations within them, but that institutions valorize people, ideas, interests, and priorities that are symbolically associated with masculinities more often than femininities, and particular kinds of masculinities, and that they make assumptions about masculinities and values that have constitutive effects on their practices, on how they function, on what they value, on what they see as effective, and so on. So, coming back to the security sector, for example, to put women into security sector organizations, when those, like every other institution, are profoundly gendered organizations, and they're gendered in that they believe that the ways in which they have chosen to enact their practices, like somebody was talking about, you know, we believe that it takes a certain kind of masculinity to have the effectiveness of a military organization, or a certain kind of masculinity to be a firefighter, or whatever it is, to put women into those organizations doesn't change the ways in which everything from their values to their symbolic meanings to what they believe is effective are shaped by ideas about masculinities and femininities. And to say that when you get to 30% it automatically changes or something like that, I think doesn't actually work. I would say similarly, if you put women, you know, say women are peace builders, women are coming into organizations, into institutions which are already constituted around those same sets of kinds of sets of values and practices. They're also constituted by the same transnational economic and political dynamics that I spoke about before, and the same, you know, kinds of relationships of militarization, corruption, exploitation, and all of that. And how do they come in there with whatever their, they're not bringing personal purity. Women as peacemakers, what they're bringing is roles and responsibilities that have made them that, right? That have made them need to take those kinds of actions. What difference does that make when you walk into these organizations that are otherwise constituted? Now, I don't think it's impossible, but I think that we can't be naive and think that women themselves can do this by themselves, and we have to be really conscious of figuring out how to make gender in organizations at a symbolic level really evident and to work at transforming at that level. And so I think that the guys in telecommunications, or that whole question, that it in part it is lack of knowledge, I agree, but it's also a belief that what it means to be a not articulated belief, I think, usually, that what it means to be a real man is to be a provider for your family, which means to, you know, do the best at work, which means profits, which means, you know, maximizing profits and shareholder goods and so on, and which does really bring you back to how do you separate, in that case, ideals of masculinity from a certain version of global capitalism and what kinds of ideas about man are embedded in it. So I don't think that you can say, you know, there's capitalism over here and masculinity over there, right? I think that, again, the things that we same thing with, you know, nuclear strategists. The things that you perceive as masculinity are absolutely embedded in making that system work, even though you're not consciously saying, I'm doing it to make that work.
Thank you. Ambassador, would you like to make some comments?
Yeah, in fact, I wanted to say something about the mineral exploitation in the Coltan story. Mm-hmm. Yeah, let me also say that the region, of course, realized the link between the atrocities committed, especially in the DRC, including the sexual violence, but also the perpetuation of the armed groups. So then they adopted, again, a legally binding agreement to put an end to this illegal exploitation of natural resources. And for 5 years, we are working on the mechanism to ensure that whoever does business with us has to be clean, has to observe the due diligence. And fortunately, the US Congress picked it up, and they passed what is called the Dodd-Frank Act. But then that went into an extreme. It was like putting an embargo on all minerals from the Great Lakes region. And they termed it as like blood. You remember the blood diamonds? And then there was, mm-hmm. So then we had to come and sensitize them. I came to Washington many times because they were, of course, punishing with that act. They would punish any company that is registered with the US Stock Exchange and doing business in minerals. But then we thought, let's now work together to ensure that the minerals that come are clean and can only be clean if you address the security challenges of the region. So that took a different dimension. And by the time I left, we had a coalition with the US companies. There's enough project initiative, European Union, Canada, and others. But then I hope this is continuing because we are putting in place the mechanism called certification mechanism that you have to show that certificate that you have acquired it through the legal means. You have taken into account the extractive industry transparency requirements. You have also observed the due diligence. Mm-hmm. But as Carol put it, of course, it is still a challenge because, you know, most of these mines where there's no authority, state authority, to be able to put them. So you find there's small planes. They come, they land in the middle of nowhere. the same armed group, the rebels, are the ones guiding those planes. They land, they fill in with the sacks of cotton, they take off. Mm-hmm. So this is what is a big challenge. So we are saying for those who have the means in power to help us deal with this problem, rather than, of course, putting a general embargo on these minerals, which, of course, they are livelihood for people.
Thank you. Gina, would you like to respond to any of them?
Sure. Yes, thank you very much for your question. It's a good one, and I'm really happy to answer it. You know, I think the challenge of getting sexual violence to be included inside of ceasefire and peace agreements is not so much a question of people negotiating it not wanting to, but not knowing how to do it. And I can say that, I think, from some firsthand experience in my work in the Mediation Support Unit at the Department of Political Affairs. And, you know, oftentimes you don't have the technical expertise that is needed to figure these components out. I mean, this guidance, which Sanam knows very well as our gender standby team expert a year ago, we had to invent this basically without any practice. So we're actively now trying to practice this craft. And I can give an example recently of the crisis in the Central African Republic. Many of you may not know about this, but there was basically a hostile takeover of the country by a rebel group called Seleka in December of 2012. And what oftentimes, and so the rebels made their way down to the capital city almost, and by January there was a political dialogue that was started. And different actors from the region, from the UN, our mission there, actively trying to come to some kind of negotiated settlement with these guys before all 5,000 of them invaded the capital city. And what happens in these processes is it's fast moving, you know, no one's talking to each other. And if you look at every ceasefire and peace agreement, they're almost replicas of each other. So we basically copy and paste. And so from my work at UN headquarters in New York, we got wind that the mediation team and some of our sort of special assets that were sent out to help the mediation, that, you know, it was middle of the night Libreville time, and they are trying to get a draft out of a ceasefire agreement because, you know, they need to get the rebels something because there's, you know, there are many civilian lives at risk. And so we get a draft. So we're asked, okay, yes, you know what, if you have something new to offer, then you have an hour. You have a whole hour to craft a ceasefire agreement. So we went back, crafted something, thought, okay, how about this? And then we get another draft from somebody else saying, we're going to use this draft. And we look at it and we think, well, that's great, but that's an exact copy of the ceasefire agreement that didn't work the first time. So how is that going to make a difference? And there's nothing in it for the rebels, and what do you do? And so in an hour, there needed to be the right kind of technical advice to make sure that not just sexual violence was included, but humanitarian access. You know, all kinds of different kinds of components that make for a more inclusive peace and an agreement that might hold. And so it just so happens that this agreement, we put in a couple of clauses on sexual violence, and we thought, okay, you know, along with other things, we thought, okay, let's see where that goes. And, you know, to our surprise, it came back signed by all sides. And so it is now the strongest ceasefire agreement that exists to date dealing with sexual violence. It's not perfect, and you know, to go back, I would probably do things differently, but we had the right kind of technical advice inside of the process. And, you know, planning and coordination is also really important because this is a complete coincidence, but this is why sometimes investment in sensitization makes a big difference, because I happened to be in the Central African Republic for a month before that. I left just a few days before these guys invaded the country. And we did a huge amount of sensitization, and then the special representative to the Secretary General on Sexual Violence and Conflict was there for a visit the week after. So the rebels themselves, in fact, had been briefed on this issue. And so I don't know to what extent that made a difference in terms of, you know, them seeing this agreement and looking at it and saying, we get it, you know, and we're going to sign it. Now, when it comes to the post-conflict context, that's a real challenge. And I think in terms of figuring out how you do it, the coordination and planning is always the problem. You know, having a robust, for instance, monitoring mechanism. One of the problems, and again, I'm going to take the Central African Republic as an example, there was a very weak ceasefire monitoring mechanism. And why is that? Because they went around looking for $300,000. Some conferences cost more than $300,000 for the ceasefire mechanism. No one would give it to them. How do you monitor a ceasefire without the bodies capable to go into towns where it might be dangerous, but you know what? Visibly, it would be good to have these guys on the ground. And lo and behold, a small group of rebels were able to completely take over the country. And so it's a matter of coordination, planning, but also financing. And sometimes, you know, in the case of the car, $300,000 a year ago that they could not find might have been enough to have prevented this hostile takeover that's happening right now.
Okay. Yeah, Susan?
Yeah. And then we'll go back. I want also to talk about a new model in Iraq about sexual violence. It's about, they name it as a pleasure marriage. Like they can get married with women maybe only for 1 hour or 2 hours. For a woman, she can get married for 2 or 3 times in a 1 day. So this is somehow, it's a kind of prostitution, but it's covered with marriage, and they put a name of pleasure marriage. So this is what I want to clarify about Iraq. Iraq, before the war, it was like a liberal and with open mind society, but all the effect, impact of war and conflict, it became like behind and worse than before, and especially for women's situation. And this is why now we are working on the resolution of 1325 on national action plan, and this is how create a political will on this national action plan to at least to make sure and guarantees women participation in peace building, in decision centers, and also for prevention. We established like this group last year in April, and now we are continuing our work on national action plan because like now it became each like group, they just want to work as they want for their interest. They taking the advantage of the week of absence of law and week of governmental institution. So we can find many kind of abuses and violence against women.
Okay, let's go back to the audience. We'll go from the top to the bottom. So I have a woman there next to those two computers, without the computer.
Can you hear me? Yes, thank you. I'm Charlotte Saxon, and I work as a gender advisor to Allied Command Operations in NATO. And as the military is, as we heard, a part of the problem, but as well as a part of the solution, I have this question for the panel. And the question is based on this fact, and I have to give this short introduction. In the headquarter where I work, which is, and that is a very nice name, long name, it's called Supreme Headquarters Allied Command Europe, SHAPE, for NATO, where we plan all our operations from a military strategic level. We have a new concept of working since 1 year ago, where we want to think, plan, and act strategically. And we launched a comprehensive operational management center, where we want to operationalize the comprehensive approach, meaning that external actors like civilian organizations, NGOs, whoever, who could feed into our thinking and knowledge and understanding, and we do understand we need that, we are depending on that, are always very much welcome. So given that, I now come to my question, which is, from your perspective, everyone in the panel, if you see all security forces, military and police out there, international security forces and local security forces, national security forces as an asset, and as I said earlier, as a part of the problem, but also a part of the solution, what could be done in, and I'm asking in quite practical, concrete terms, what could be done that is not done today? Thank you.
Thank you. Then I've got the young woman here with the white shirt.
Thank you. Alejandra Suero from Harvard University. And I had a, my question is kind of inspired by what some of Carol's comments and Colonel comments too on the transnational global dimensions. I'm thinking about one of the few issues that we haven't raised is that of private security contractors, which today all around the world perform police and military functions. And we know quite well that many of, oftentimes, they are the ones in charge of working alongside corporations to secure that the extraction and their business runs smoothly, which oftentimes includes sexual violence as a strategy of terror. And so as a lawyer, I understand that there's a whole different regime of liability for private security contractors, right? But I'm curious as to what the panel thinks, particularly those of you who are thinking of security reform, about private, about these particular agents within this very complex sphere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then I have here a woman in the white sweater, and then we go to the gentleman sort of across from her behind.
Hi, Anka Mason from Uma Janao, and this is addressed to the whole panel. In terms of security sector and security sector reform and the fight for freedom from sexual violence, how has the US-led war on terror, which was created in a very racialized, gendered way, where we as the US utilize torture memos and tortured the bodies of dark male prisoners in Guantanamo and other hidden sites around the world, left them without the right to process in violation of many international agreements. How has this influenced, or how have you seen a connection within the last, well, this has been since 2001, how has this influenced, in your opinion, the opinions of those countries around the world that we now stand and point to and try to hold accountable for the use of sexual violence in warfare, where we have not been held accountable as a country ourselves, and where we have steadfastly refused to even ratify CEDAW, which is a major document of accountability within the international treaty regime. Thanks.
Okay, this is a bit more of a comment. I'm Robert Agnell from Georgetown University. I'll try and be as controversial as possible right now. Because I'm slightly disappointed. When it comes to sexual violence, one of the strong sides is that you speak very clearly and graphically about the nature of this problem. That is something that has shocked the world to some extent, but is the strength of this field. When it comes to the solutions to protection, suddenly it all becomes very fluffy. It is sort of bottom-up processes. It is empowerment. And I'm wondering, shouldn't we be as graphic as and as specific when it comes to protection as when it comes to the problem of sexual violence, right? So when we are speaking about, for example, we've heard different kinds of sexual violence or different types of perpetrators. And if we look at them, a few of them just, take the ordered sexual violence on a massive scale within certain armed groups. How do we deal with that? Surely not human rights education and bottom-up processes, something like that. It's about deterrence or compellence or by defeating them on the battlefield. Let's not kid ourselves when it comes to that. When it comes to post-conflict combatants who are perpetuating the cycle of violence, how do we deal with those? Again, is the problem that they don't know the human rights of the women and men they are sexually violating? Surely not. Again, it is the justice system, it's the courts. How many police officers per 1,000 inhabitants do we need on the streets? How many courts? How many prisons, for example? It's very tangible, hardcore things we should talk about, I think, as well. So that was just my comment, and I'd be very happy to hear your thoughts on it.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think that's very good, and it ties in with the question that was asked, you know, practically, what can you do about this? And it goes back to the issue of the use of force and intervention, military intervention. So anybody who would like to pick up on this? Biram Job, do you want? This is about military intervention. So should we have something like an R2PW?
No, I agree with him that we need to be more specific and have concrete actions against sexual violence. But in the meantime, we need also to acknowledge the fact that sexual violence is not an isolated thing. It is in an environment with a lot of factors that are affecting directly this problem. So you need to have, yes, a focused approach, but also a holistic approach. This is what I can say. No, some of us will be focused, some others will have a holistic, and we complement each other.
And maybe this is very controversial, but we have to get beyond the fluffy. I mean, the fact is, yes, in order to address perpetrators of sexual violence, you have to be ensuring that, and I'm going to just bring up the case of the Central African Republic again, a place where you don't have prisons. You don't have, so funding for being able to deal with, even if you had a functioning justice system, where do you place people? And I'll give you a small antidote. I went to a very small town called Ndele, which is actually where the rebels began their invasion of the country. And I briefed security actors and parties to the agreement. At night, I had the town prosecutor come in the cover of darkness to find me, to tell me about some of the rapes that had taken place in their village. And when I asked him the question of, well, what happens if you were to try to prosecute this? There's no place to put them. And so I think the question of, how do you actually physically deal with eliminating a culture of impunity is important, and it is important to get beyond the fluffy. We do have to think concretely about how do you then take the next practical steps to be able to make a difference, even if it's very small.
Yes, Beth?
Yeah, can I also say, of course, I do want to get into the details of the practicalities. He has just questioned with all these agreements that have been signed. It goes with what needs to, the steps to be taken. For example, from Kampala, you have 8 decisions to deal with the question of prevention, to deal with the issue of the impunity, to deal with the issue of the military, and to deal with the issue of protection of victims. And for each component, for example, of course, with the impunity, I didn't want to repeat it because yes, it was said all over and over again, having special courts, having mobile courts, special sessions, cutting down on the long procedures, do it in camera. These were the commitments that were made, and bringing on board all those who can make a difference on this. But more important is to deal with the fundamental problem and the fundamental problem of the security issue, of being able to achieve stability in the DRC. And the military intervention that has been decided, and we are still hoping that the UN will see that it's high time that they should let the region do it. Because we have a peacekeeping force. This is called MONUSCO, Stabilization Force, which has been in Congo for the last 16 years. But we still have rebellion. So at the last summit, the heads of state, the countries of the region, decided that we need to deal with the rebels once and for all. And they call them the negative forces, the M23. You deal with the M23 today, but tomorrow, they will occur. So now they are saying we have to do all the military while continuing with the political approach. There is negotiations ongoing in the Kampala as I'm speaking with those rebels, but they have been saved the notice that the region leader will not accept to continue with this rebellion. So, and when I'm speaking, the ministers of the gender, and the unfortunate most of the ministers of gender are women, have been meeting, but they said you have to bring on board the ministers of justice, the ministers of defense, let's meet together, the ministers of health and all the health sector stakeholders and the civil society. Let's deal now with this problem once and for all. So I must say, what I've been seeking, and maybe in my conclusion, what I'm asking is if this regional effort could be recognized and supported. I was disappointed yesterday when the special representative was talking of the, and there was no reference on what has been happening, even with the Central African Republic, because they're also part of this initiative. There's been a lot going on, but then we lack the means, we lack the financing, but we lack the international community support. Yesterday, somebody talked about the international community referring to the North. It is true, because we always see there is so much lacking. There is so much research, as you are saying, and then I said, who is the consumer of these findings? So really, we need to form a movement. We need to form this coalition. And this is why I had to come all the way, because I said, for the first time, the U.S. Institute of Peace has decided to bring everybody who has been dealing on this issue, because we seem to be doing it on a very fragmented approach. We do little, but then the situation continues. That's why I agree with you that we need to come up with the very concrete steps, what needs to be done. And that's why I'm also waiting for tomorrow's session, the way forward from here. I thank you.
Mm-hmm. Carol, would you like?
I think I need to start with a meta comment or observation, which is, I'm wondering what fluffy is. And I note that it is a feminized word, and that the alternatives to fluffy were militarized, right? It was defeat on the battlefield, compellents, police, prisons, highly masculinized, militarized security responses. And so that's interesting, isn't it? And I think that it is that part of what it means to talk about the ways in which gender operates at a symbolic level is that it is much easier for us to see the masculinized security militarized responses as effective, which I think is part of what fluffy is not supposed to be, right? As effective and efficient, and that some of these other things that sound more, you know, fluffy, touchy-feely, it's harder to see them as effective. So I do very much want to echo what my co-panelists have said. I think you need holistic, multi-level responses. You need all of these things. You do need functioning judicial systems and penal systems. There's no question about it. But it's also true that if you demobilize or try to demobilize and disarm men who are perpetrators who have been in militaries or non-state armed groups for years and years and years, and you neither find ways to reset what does it mean to be a real man, reset what does it mean to, what ways do I have of being in relation to women, in relation to my family, and if you don't provide alternative means of livelihood, right? That without doing those things, which are both consciously, purposefully addressing gender, and also very material, unfluffy, economic, and finally, the fundamental problem you said is we haven't gotten to stability, right? Well, stability is really difficult to come to in highly militarized societies that are flooded with weapons, right? And so it's also, so I think that we have to take, you know, disarmament at a larger scale than just the particular fighters who are being demobilized much more seriously. And again, to the extent that weapons are a means of livelihood for fighters, then you're also, and a central part of masculine identity for fighters, you're back to dealing with those other two levels.
Now, if I could just respond to that, I appreciate your comments about masculinity, which I think, you know, academics and policy planners should take into consideration, but I think that we have to be careful about making an enemy out of the masculine. And because concretely, if you are in a town in the Central African Republic on the border of Chad, there are things missing. There are schools missing, police missing, mobile courts missing, basic things missing. And I think that, you know, and I think that those concrete things are getting beyond the fluffy. I don't find fluffy a feminine word. Fluffy is a word for not concrete, which I don't take as feminine. For instance, I think we have to be careful. I just think we have to be careful about making an enemy out of the masculine.
That's great. Thank you, Gina. I'm sure we can have hours and hours of discussion and continue. I just wanted to give a word to Susan, who's also eager to make a comment. Thank you.
Yeah. In order to solving this problem, the problem is not with numbers of police officers or judges, but about quality. Quality, because I'm talking according to my experience in my country. So the problem that they are, that people like police officers or judges dealing with those cases, and most like violated cases, it become there. They are violating the cases for second and third time. So this is a big problem. So we have to work on the capacity building. Civic education, it's very important. There's lack of human rights concept with police officers, with judges, even in my country with all the new laws, even like the domestic violence law being adopted last year, but without any mechanism of implementing this law. So this is the real problem. We have to have, maybe we can build on the new generation and forget about the old people. It is very difficult to change mentality. And still judges that cannot accept the new law, and they talking about Sharia. And even they mix between what's culture, traditional law, and what's law. So they mixed all together, and they mostly using the culture law instead of civil law. So this is, again, another big problem. We also need the commitment from state in front of all the convention regarding women rights, like CEDAW and the resolution 1325. So we need solidarity. This is very important. We need solidarity on national base, on regional base, and international base. This is how we become strong and strong. For example, for me, it is very difficult when I want to talk with the stakeholders in my country, and sometimes they cannot accept what I'm telling them, but it will be good to have solidarity on regional and international. So they have to listen, they have to change. So this is what we need, especially for women's rights and women, what they are facing. So I believe with solidarity, we can change a lot. And also, we need the support from international organization for the local NGOs, because they are the key player of change. Now, as I know, most of the UN agencies, they are busy with most of government institutions working on a long strategies without allocating any resource for implementing the strategy. It stays as strategies. So this is what we are facing. We don't have the real action through, like for our like victims to respond to them, any kind of protection. We are busy just designing very long term strategies and useless strategies.
Well, I think everybody will agree with me that we actually need another panel, because we have only scratched the surface of, there are many other issues that remain on the table, like the abuse by UN peacekeepers, the consequences of the US war on terror, Abu Ghraib, the whole issue of intervention, what we do right now about the situation in Syria, in Mali. So I think we need to have another panel on this particular issue. But please thank me, help me thank the panelists. And I would also like to thank you for your very thoughtful questions and comments. So
thank you.
Yeah, so we resume here at 4 o'clock. We now have a 30-minute break. Okay.
have the energy to hang on and listen to yet another speech. Today I will be speaking about what I call Lubanga case, the changing paradigm. And I'm sure most of you already know what the case was about, so let me just briefly review that Thomas Jala Lubango from the Democratic Republic of Congo was indicted or charged by the International Criminal Court on three counts: enlisting, conscripting, and using children to participate actively in hostilities. Now, there's more or less, how can I say diplomatically, a known factor, the public secret, that there was quite a bit of sexual violence that occurred in the Ituri province when he was actually present among the persons who came to testify, and that probably could have been placed into the charging document. What is officially on the public record is that we will go back and possibly amend the case to bring in those charges. There was no amendment, and so there was no submission before the trial chamber in the form of a charge of evidence of sexual violence, but the evidence of sexual violence came in as factual background. Mr. Lubanga was convicted for all three counts of conscripting, enlisting, and using children to participate actively in hostilities, or active participation. So what I would like to do today is, first of all, to say that there are some highlights to that case. And usually, feminists are not supposed to have any case be highlighted and have anything positive happen to it if sexual violence didn't get included. We're supposed to be in stark mourning. So I want to remind you of some things that were included that we should take note of. And that certainly was the decision on reparations. It is the first International Criminal Court decision, and that decision includes quite a healthy framework for how reparations are to be given out. And that it did include, I think, a couple of legal gems that I will go over in my presentation. But it is obvious that the silence that absolutely screamed was the absence of sexual violence and its consideration. Now, one might say, was there a misuse or lack of consideration of sexual violence as a legal matter? And according to the dissent of Judge Odio Benito from Costa Rica, she says that even if charges were not submitted, that the trial chamber could have legally defined some of the crimes, enlistment, and in particularly active participation, using sexual violence as a matter to look at the law and not to judge the factual basis of the crimes. This case somewhere reminds me of the first case of the Yugoslav tribunal, the prosecutor versus Tadic. And if you, those of you who remember and those of you who have read recent history, will note that in that first case, the prosecutor had to withdraw the testimony of witness F, a woman who did not come forward, who was supposed to testify about sexual violence. And so many people thought, not many people, let us be Burmung family, the feminists thought, oh my goodness, the case is now a failure. And what the feminists overlooked, and many international criminal lawyers overlooked, is that there was a man who was to testify concerning male sexual violence and gang rape. The prosecutor had to remove this man's testimony because of issues of collateral credibility. But I never see that picked up in the feminist analysis. And then the other thing that occurred in Tadic was it was the first conviction for sexual violence at the Yugoslav tribunal, and lo and behold, the sexual conviction related to male sexual assault. I think many of you remember what we refer to as the testicle incident, when two men were asked to bite off the testicles of a third man in detention. Moving back toward Mr. Lubanga, the issue is the same. Let's not be blinded necessarily by what was not in there so that we can focus what is on there. So a couple more highlights. The reparations decision is a decision that included sexual violence. The fact that it was an international criminal court case that included children, some were officialized, even beyond the special court for Sierra Leone, the harms and danger that could come to children. The fact that it addressed issues such as what is actively participating can only be seen as a step forward in international criminal law. So we must look at what is present and what we can use. Okay, now to what was potential and what was not used. I think I've been able to say that I'm balanced at this point. I think that a feminist analysis of humanitarian law is what should be applied to the Lubanga case. And if you allow me to be pretentious, let me walk you through my version of the feminist analysis of international humanitarian law as it relates to Lubanga. First of all, there has been a push, of which I have been a part of, I plead guilty, to, as feminists, we want to make sure that we're included in humanitarian law. We want to be part of the grave breaches, the pinnacle of humanitarian law. And so feminist analysis has spent a lot of time trying to make sure that grave breaches in parts of international humanitarian law are interpreted so that they are not still traditionally masculine. And I'll give you an example. And that, of course, relates to torture. When under Rwanda, Yugoslavia, and under Special Court for Sierra Leone, that sexual violence, i.e. rape, could be a form of torture. That was seen as a victory because we masculinized, we recognized torture as being masculine, and then we hierarchized, or whatever the verb should be, of making it a hierarchy of grave breaches. And since rape wasn't named as a grave breach, we wanted to make sure that rape-like conduct got into the grave breaches, but not just as willfully causing grave suffering, not just as cruel treatment or inhumane acts. Push it up, make it torture. So a feminist analysis, we've spent quite a bit of time and energy just to get on the playing field. I say to land at the beach on Normandy. And we did the same thing with genocide. Genocide was composed of sexual violence that occurred during the Rwanda conflict. But if you look at genocide law, you will see that its origins from Nuremberg included sexual acts, included protections in terms of forms of sexual violence. Imposing measures to prevent birth really relates to some of the experiments of sterilization that took place during the Holocaust. But it was as if we've made it into genocide when the Akiyesu case was delivered, because now rape was a part of genocide. You see, we've hit that hierarchy of international criminal law. And to a certain extent, we've been very happy with occupying the grave breaches, occupying the serious violations of humanitarian law, and occupying genocide. But I think that we should have a more modern discussion. And the modern discussion, of course, means that we should not only occupy, we should reconceptualize. I do give credit and am completely grateful, as all of us sitting in this room should be, that war crimes such as outrageous upon personal dignity recognizes sexual violence, that the Rome Statute has expanded not only under war crimes but under crimes against humanity forms of sexual violence, that it is gender neutral, that it applies to males and females, meaning boys and girls, grown women and grown men. And also, we're very happy that sexual violence as part of genocide conduct is starting to be normalized. Finally, we're just not counting the dead bodies and saying, oh, what does the genocide look like? We're starting to ask men and women of what happened sexually during genocides. So I think that we should take these victories, but I think Lubanga has showed us that occupying and just applying the methodology we have now is too limited, or is becoming too limited. Lubanga should permit us now to analyze not just whether we fit into the express provisions, such as the crimes, but I think that we need to look at the doctrines and the norms and the principles, along with the express prohibitions, and look and see if humanitarian law is responsive to the facts that incorporate men, women, boys, and girls. Now, this is a prolongation, possibly, of Christine Chinkin, Hillary Charlesworth, Michelle Jarvis's analysis. But I'd ask you to commence with me a type of reconceptualization so that we can evolve beyond this normative sphere of international humanitarian law. A shifting paradigm should begin. And we'll begin it with Lubanga. Why Lubanga? Well, it presents a hidden secret, and it has to do with the fact that it's children in armed conflict. It's boys and girls. And as Radhika Komasamswamy, the former special representative for children armed conflict, said, Patty, no one wants to be against boys and girls. Everyone agrees to more protection for them. So let's look at the protection that Lubanga gave, or maybe the limits of protection that international humanitarian law afford Lubanga. First of all, I'm going to say the obvious. Enlistment and conscription of children is a war crime. That means that these acts have to take place during a war, right? These are not crimes that are crimes against humanity or genocide that could take place when there is no war apparent. There has to be some type of prolonged armed conflict. Since they only take place during wartime, these acts have to have a nexus with an armed conflict. Well, so far, nothing strange about that. But when you look at international armed conflict and its governing body of law, the Geneva Conventions, remember that the leading doctrine of the Geneva Conventions is that there are four protected groups. You're protected if you're wounded on land. You're protected if you're shipwrecked. You're protected if you're a prisoner of war, and you're protected if you're a civilian. Now, the question I would ask you, when children are enlisted or conscripted, and I might use the generic term of recruited, are they protected only if they're wounded, only if they're shipwrecked, if they're prisoners of war? Do those categories really fit children who are child soldiers? Are they protected if they're civilians, but if they're found to be child soldiers, they're no longer civilians? Humanitarian law is reaching somewhere its outer limits when we talk about child soldiers and traditional Geneva protection. Well, since they're not protected in the normal sense, what does that mean? Well, the normal sense means that anyone who's a protected person in those categories gets what is called bottom line, we cannot go below this treatment, humane treatment. It is the absolute pillar of the Geneva Conventions. So what kind of treatment do we give children who are conscripted and enlisted precisely during a war? What type of treatment are they afforded? Can we really discuss humane treatment synonymously with a child soldier? Well, let's just shift the paradigm a bit. Let's not talk about international armed conflict, the four protected categories. Let's move to internal armed conflict, because that's much easier. You don't have to be a protected person, you just have to be hors de combat, outside of combat. And anyone, soldier, any person, soldier puts down their arms, they're protected, they're outside of combat. Our child soldier, is our child soldier ever outside of combat? Do the normalized doctrines of humanitarian law readily apply to them? No child who is enlisted or conscripted can simultaneously be outside of combat. They can put down their arms, and maybe the opposite side would have to treat them as a prisoner of war, or then recognize them as a protected person, but in the everyday life of the child soldier, there is no outside of combat. So the humane treatment that comes with internal armed conflict, that doesn't readily apply to how we look at child soldiers. In addition to that, let me just tell you that the other primary stance of humanitarian law is that there's supposed to be no adverse distinction, people to be treated the same. No adverse distinction based upon sex or age. But since these norms really don't apply to children, we can't say the child has been discriminated against concerning their age or sex. Once again, they've fallen outside of our norms. Isn't this a little disturbing to you? It is to me. So children seem to be that exception. They seem to make international humanitarian law, kind of slightly burst at the seam. And if children aren't granted, per se, humane treatment, no adverse distinction, what does humanitarian law offer are least capable, those who are least capable of defending themselves. Well, while you're holding that thought, let me go to something that Lubanga did that I thought was positive. It said that in relationship to conscription and enlistment, we will not be concerned, it is legally irrelevant, as to whether the child consented to be enlisted or conscripted. Consent shall not be relevant. And the reason they said that consent is not relevant is that because a child has an immature mind. A child cannot conceive of killing or being killed. A child cannot contemplate death. I don't know how many of you can really contemplate death. I think it's something that even the most mature of us have problems facing. But because of that, whether the child consented to be in the army or not, state-wise or non-state, is completely irrelevant. Now, some of you must know what I'm sniffing around. International humanitarian law usually is not concerned with issues of consent or not, except when it comes to sexual violence and how much time and energy as feminists have we debated where does consent or lack thereof come in according to the sexual violence that the protection of grave breaches or the parts of humanitarian law were offered. We should take an analogy of saying the child who cannot consent to contemplate death, that should be the type of new budding doctrine within humanitarian law. Things that are inconceivable, not just to children, but to adults. And I would make two steps. I would say that under international humanitarian law and international criminal law, some of you might be aware that issues of consent even relate to children when they relate to sexual violence. So you would have to ask that same child who can't consent to being conscripted, did you consent to this sexual violence, this rape, and therefore now you have a child? This same unthinking child is going to be asked about their consent in terms of sexual violence, whether it be gang rape or other forms of rape, while they are child soldiers. I believe that's a contradiction. International criminal law has no provision at this point in time to say children cannot consent to sexual violence, even if they're under 15, or if we want to go to the age of 18. Under international law, 18 is the real age of the child. There's no provision to say automatically under 18, consent is legally irrelevant for sexual abuse, and particularly rape, nor can it be a defense. I think this is something that Lubanga has offered us, and I think feminist analysis should look at this, create a doctrine, and expand it to other areas, applying it to children and to adults. I would also like to say that statutory law in the domestic system readily understands that a child is not capable of certain things. We are not there yet in terms of international humanitarian law. It is a weakness within the humanitarian law. I would go so far as to say it's a weakness in understanding what is humane treatment. But then we could just make it a little bit lighter and say, well, why don't we just have the rule, the normal rule, where usually officers or persons of a higher rank are not supposed to fraternize, code word, have sexual relationships with their subordinates. Children in armed conflict, that has not been the equation. The equation has been, have they been subjected to sexual violence? Military rules all of a sudden have gone out of the window. But that's because children are in this funny situation. Neither protected by the Geneva Conventions totally in the normative way, nor protected under Common Article 3, nor really seen as children or as soldiers holding the thought at the same time. And I think that when you look at the discussion among the judges in Lubanga, that this is what the argument is about. They're trying to configure a way that humanitarian law applies to children who are child soldiers. Now, the last part concerns active participating in hostilities. Now, you might know that this active participating in hostilities has usually meant that the perpetrator should not put the child on the front line of war. War does not have these traditional front lines that it might have had. When the American Revolution came and, you know, you wore red suits on one side and, I don't know, blue suits on the other side, or the traditional front lines are very masculine lines. War doesn't take place like that anymore. We can look every night on our TV in Syria. But this masculine conscript of actively participating in hostilities was the case, or I'm sorry, the test that was provided for child soldiers. And there was a great division on should it be directly participating or not directly participating, what is the risk and harm that the child is exposed to, and from the dissent of Judge Jody Benito, should we count in girl children of sexual violence, is that direct participation or not? Does that offer support or not support, or direct support or in support, or on the front line or off the front line? And it's absolutely crazy. Why is it crazy? Because if that child has been enlisted or conscripted, that child is a member of the non-state actors' armed forces or the national armed forces. And every member of an armed force can be targeted. Once you're a member of an armed force, the other side is allowed to kill you during war. So it really doesn't matter whether you're on the front line or not. They can overrun the camp. They can send spies behind line. They can walk up and shoot you if you're a member of that armed force. So while we spend a lot of time seeing, well, is this active participation? Is this support? Is this direct or in support? Oh my goodness, can we get sexual violence within that discussion so that we can be present and occupy the line? We've kind of missed the falseness of the entire premise and the masculinity of the premise in terms of war. But aha, you might say. These crimes are in the alternative, Patty. It can be enlistment or conscription or using children to actively participate. And since they can be in the alternative, some of the children who are used to actively participate, well, maybe they haven't been enlisted and conscripted. You with me? Maybe they're still civilians. You say, oh, okay. Well, if they're civilians, and we're debating about whether they're participating actively or indirectly or directly or supporting, then why didn't someone say, oh, well, Geneva Convention number 4 comes into play there. You can't put civilians in the front line. You know, they're owed humane treatment. They're protected per se. There's no civilian test about active and non-active or direct and indirect participation or risk. And so once again, we see children in armed conflict. If we look closely at Lubanga, we start to see the fault lines. And the fault lines are in the doctrines of humanitarian law. If there is a new place to occupy, if there is for us a breaking of traditional thinking, we should do it by using Lubanga. If it cannot protect the most incapable or vulnerable of us, then these doctrines can be questioned. They're not compatible with humane treatment. International humanitarian law seems to have hobbled together under customary law of how we protect children. And it's in the absence, really, of sexual violence that makes us really look closer at Lubanga. I would ask you to lean in and look closer, truly closer. We should be prompted to ask questions of saying, yes, we should fit into the interpretation, but we should go beyond the interpretation. Yes, we should look at the gender context of international humanitarian law, but we should even go beyond its gendered context to create a new context. And yes, we should debate agency or non-agency, but not in issues of whether a child wanted to walk up to the front line, whether a child wanted to be the sexual slave of commander. And we should also ask questions of why hasn't anyone categorized the children born of child soldiers? Are they civilians? Or are they descendants of child soldiers? Is that a category? Are they on the front line? Is that direct or indirect support? Is that just a gap in our humane treatment and protection? I would say so. I would say the norms, all these norms of humane treatment, adverse distinction, collateral damage, indiscriminate use of weapons. I would say that we need to go back and reconceptualize Charles Ruth Chinkin Jarvis, a feminist analysis of the Geneva Conventions of International Humanitarian Law. Our reconceptualization should not be intimidated, by the masculine norms of international humanitarian law. They have to apply to all peoples, children and adults. I would say that even in the absence of what we would have wanted to see most in Lubanga, we have gained a precious gift, because Lubanga highlights that precarious precipice of humanitarian law, but yet it has given us the seismic shifts, and I think we can shift the paradigm. Thank you very much. Yes. I'm supposed to go sit over there now. Right. I'm supposed to follow you. You're supposed to walk around me. And then we'll be right. Those are my instructions.
About 15 minutes for questions. So let's take a few. Let's take a bundle of three again, and then you can choose. Or even four or five, and then we'll let Patty choose whatever she wants to focus on. Questions, please. Okay, the gentleman right here from Sierra Leone, please. And then,
Thank you very much for the presentation. And it was nice you have some examples from Sierra Leone. So my question is also from Sierra Leone. According to research report by Physicians of Human Rights from United States, 2009, up to 600,000 women and girls were abused during the war. Well, at the end of the war, when the special court for Sierra Leone was established, what we had, when I say we, down to the grassroots, the underserved communities, the local people, was only those who bear the greatest penalty were prosecuted. So it's so good that we have been invited to some of this forum to come and see for ourselves and hear and share the experiences. But there was nothing stated relating to war-related sexual violence. When we very well know there's an established record of over 600,000 women and girls that were abused. And thank God the case is still with you people in the Hague. So I don't know how we'll be able to factor some of these things so that at the end of it all, the rest of the, because it were only a few people that were arrested. Majority of the ex-combatants and what have you are all there. They abuse our sisters, our wives, our mothers and aunties, and they are going almost scot-free. So how do we bring them accountable so that we'll really factor that to know that it's not only the weaponry, it's not only the shooting and killing and maiming, but they are being brought before law because of sexual-related violence, which have an evidence, out of which you have copies of those information. Thank you.
Thank you.
Klaus, can I just follow up on that?
Let me check, see if anyone else has a question. No? Oh, okay, if you can make it quick then, thank you.
You sound up.
Sure.
I have been a refugee many times, in DRC, in Tanzania, and so forth. Most of the leaders who committed crimes against civilians, today they are praised. And I'm saying like Paul Kagame, there are many, many people who are still waiting to see ICC or international human rights laws or naming and bringing those people to justice. We have many good reports and proof about, for instance, Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni, during his time of fighting, using child soldiers. Nothing is being talked about it today. But we see immediately in Cote d'Ivoire, Laurent Gbagbo is in court. Yes, we have to do that. We have to appreciate that. We're seeing other leaders immediately. Is it ICC a political tool to go after certain leaders and others are praised or not? Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me answer if I could.
Sure.
I think in the first instance,
Sarah, you were talking about Liberia? And Sierra Leone, okay. Because it's the same issue in Liberia. Those cases that have not been picked up by the special court for Sierra Leone predate the jurisdiction of the ICC. But there has to be a push for either national prosecutions or, you know, that word we're not supposed to use, universal jurisdiction. Because it is the world's responsibility to bring such persons to justice. And for yours, in terms of your questions, really, is there selective prosecution? Why can't we get, then everyone should be prosecuted, or no one should be prosecuted, or how do we select those who should be prosecuted? And not everyone's favorite warlord is going to be picked up. And that's not a satisfactory situation, but that is a situation. But your real question is, there has to be a certain amount of honesty and integrity in terms of the cases that are selected. And the cases that we will allow national courts, universal jurisdiction, to take over. And I could only agree with you that that selection has to go. I don't know if that would entail all of the opposite sides of who has been selected to be prosecuted.
Okay, let's come over to this side a little bit. This lady right here, please. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nicole Gehring from Wayne State University in Detroit, Michigan. And I have two questions. One is theoretical, one's practical. Theoretically, should women be given a special class status in international humanitarian law, and to what degree would that continue to perpetuate these issues we have with empowering masculinities and, you know, treating women as vulnerable citizens who need to be protected? Secondly, could you speak to the kind of burden of evidence that you might need to prosecute cases of rape as a war crime, and the problems maybe with that burden in trying to ensure these cases can go forward effectively?
Okay. Let's take one more right now. Hassan?
Thank you. Hassan Biliti from Liberia. My question to you is, why is it that the ICC has not prosecuted anybody, or has not even made attempt to prosecute anybody in the case of Liberia, the Liberian War? Even though Sierra Leone, we know that President Taylor was prosecuted for crimes he committed, not in Liberia, but in Sierra Leone. Why is that? And then you talk about local courts prosecuting, setting up commissions to prosecute people. Well, in the case of Liberia, a commission was set up called the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and they completed their job, and then the leadership literally took the document and just put it in the drawer, which opens a lot of other doors for people to individually, you know, sue people other places. So the main question is why the ICC has really not done anything at all, not one for Liberia.
Right, the ICC will not do one because it's a question of jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. The jurisdiction starts running for the ICC after the period of the war in Liberia. So that's why I'm going back to universal jurisdiction or other war crimes chambers. It cannot, jurisdictional-wise, do anything, the retroactive prosecution. And for the question over here, I remember the evidence part. What was the first part of her question? Excuse me. Special protection for women. Well, humanitarian law already provides special protection for women in two or three instances. That there's special, there are certain provisions that just relate to the special dignity and honor of women, and there are provisions that relate to no adverse distinction based upon sex, and provisions that relate to women and children. And there's been a critique as to whether these provisions embody a certain form of paternalism in there, or when one puts the no adverse distinction based upon sex, age, health, or any other factor, is that not an equity issue, that's something that's very positive and it's how we interpret it. So that's already part of humanitarian law, particularly under Geneva law as a doctrine. But there's has been clarified adverse distinction in terms of sexuality and sexual orientation, whether that's an interpretation of sex or their limits. In terms of evidence for cases related to sexual violence, it's very case specific, whether you need the viva voce of the survivor, if the person has survived, eyewitness, hearsay, documentary. There can be some forensic evidence. It depends on very much the factual basis. And you have to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, such as under any criminal jurisdiction.
Okay. A couple more questions in our limited time. Right here, please.
I wanted to ask you if you could expand on, you said this case presents an opportunity to open a new paradigm, to develop new doctrine. If it were up to you, what would that new doctrine look like?
Thank you. Let's take another, who has not had a chance to ask a question yet. Chantal, sorry, Chantal. Let's go right here. Sorry, Chantal. Yes, please, right here. Yes. You will have time.
Thank you. My name is Aisling Swain. I'm from the Transitional Justice Institute at the University of Ulster in Northern Ireland. I really enjoyed your analysis and critique. Thank you. Just would love to hear from you on what you think about, given your critique, the inclusion of reference to gender issues, gender analysis, and sexual violence in the principles and reparations that then come out of the trial chamber. So it'd be great to hear your thoughts around that. Thanks.
Squeeze in one more for you to consider. One more question then, right? Yes, right here, thanks.
I have a quick question. Have you thought in any capacity about nuancing what is considered to be the age of adulthood? Because we have this random designation of 18, but in each of the cultures in which the ICC is operating, what is considered to be adult changes. And sometimes it's a physical change, but sometimes there's a some sort of event around it. Mm-hmm. So the problem is by having this Western imposed concept of 18, when in their own cultures they're already adults, seems that we've hit some sort of disconnect.
Yes, okay, let me work backwards. I mean, I think the 18-year-old, now there's additional optional protocol concerning 18. I think as most things that are policy decisions, you're gonna catch some people on one side and some people on the other side, which means countries on other sides. And if you look at the age of majority, it often is very related to the rural nature of a country or not. Because, for example, in Darfur or Sudan, I mean, they're 14-year-olds who herd the family treasures of goats. I mean, in the States, you wouldn't send a 14-year-old to take care of your bank account no matter what. So there is something bound up within a cultural effect. But I think international law is also a law that's built upon compromises. And the prior compromise was 15 years old. And that's why we have enlistment and conscription of children under 15 is what the war crime is. Because after World War II, many industrialized countries allowed children to go to mandatory education until eighth grade, till they were 15. And then they could decide to do something else, such as join the army. So it is cultural, but it is political, and I think that you just have to make a decision. From my point of view, I think 18 is becoming increasingly more so that we have populations that are extending mandatory high school education, and the notion of being a grown-up at 16 and 17 is losing a bit of its value in more places since World War II. So I'd tied with that. In terms of the doctrines I would like to see change, I think you could get the hint. I think actively participating in hostilities, to me, has no sense anymore. If you're a member of the armed forces, you're a target. And if you're not a member of the armed forces, you should be protected on Geneva IV. So we shouldn't be debating on whether you participate directly or non-directly or actively. And I think notions of consent that we can extend to child soldiers, but yet always ask a man or a woman who's in detention during a war, did you consent to that? I just think that that's absolutely ridiculous. I think we need to explore our notions of consent during armed conflict, just as we explore our notions of consent for people who are in domestic jails. Prisoners are just not allowed to have sex with inmates. No further questions.
Okay,
And in terms of the reparations, I think the reparations decision was meaty, it was full, I think, for a first decision to give a framework to set up what is almost like another chamber, almost like a magistrate administration of the reparations. I think they tried to look at issues of individualism, of collectivity, what is short-term harm, what is long-term harm. And for a first decision to come out of that trial chamber, when you look back at the sentencing decision and the substantive decision where you have the judges apparently in disagreement over many things, that this was a harmonious, almost a full bench acknowledgement of the importance of victims who participated and how reparations are now a part of justice.
Okay, thank you. I think we're actually out of time. So another thing that could have been a whole day of a symposium next time. But thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. It says in the program that we are now going to have a reception, which we will, but as opposed to yesterday, where we had a few talks during the reception outside, we decided to have them here before we go in today. So if you bear with me for a few more minutes, I would like to introduce the chairman of the board of directors for the Peace Research Endowment, who is sponsoring the reception taking place in a few minutes. It's Joe Reeder. And Joe Reeder's distinguished career spans private law practice and public service. He's a shareholder of Greenberg Traurig LLP, one of the largest U.S. law firms. And as the 14th Undersecretary of the U.S. Army from 1993 to 97, he was responsible for long-range planning, readiness, acquisition reform, infrastructure, reduction and financial management, and for military support to local, state, and federal agencies relating to civilian law enforcement, disaster relief, and emergency planning. He also served as the Army's focal point for international affairs, particularly for NATO, Panama, and Latin America. And he chairs, he chairs several boards, including the International Advisory Board of the Panama Canal and a number of charities. He chairs the Ethics Committee of the Board of Governors of the National Defense Industry Association, and he holds degrees from Georgetown, the University of Texas, and West Point. And he is then also the chairman of the board for the Peace Research Endowment, now working to raise money for peace research, including research on sexual violence. So we're looking forward to what you have to say to us before we enjoy the wine and nibbles that you are paying for.
Inger, thank you. About half of what she said is right about me. So thank you for that, because I'm just honored to be here, and on behalf of your host, the Peace Research Endowment, and our Board of Governors, Peace Board of Governors, welcome. I was supposed to say this out that little door where hopefully you will go in about 4.5 minutes and enjoy, and they gave me some sunglasses to wear out there because it was very bright. We hope you're finding the conference stimulating and deepening the discourse on ways to prevent and respond to often overlooked but directly related to conflict sexual violence. As you've discussed over the past 2 days, the calculated use of SV in conflict leaves scars that permanently destroy the fabric of lives and communities, often in ways that render lasting peace a mirage. This tactic of war perpetrated much more against women and girls, often also victimizes men and boys. It is happening today as we meet in Syria and in Mali. You might properly wonder what I, as former 82nd Airborne Division officer and and then later Deputy Secretary of the Army might add to this dialogue. But I'm proud to tell you that culturally in the United States, many of us understand that those who hold most dear and sacred peace are military. This, we are sitting now in the Carlucci Auditorium. Frank Carlucci was the Secretary of Defense and has contributed immeasurably to the cause of peace. So I don't know a lot, but I cannot overstress the importance of a couple things: command, responsibility, and consequences. And by consequences, I mean strict accountability. Abu Ghraib, a horrible embarrassment for soldiers the world over and for the United States, included sexual abuse. Sexual violence in conflict that can be commanded once it is spotlighted, obviously, also can be controlled. Post 9/11, some quibbled as to whether and when Geneva Conventions should apply. That dialogue was deeply painful to many of us. When I was a young cadet at West Point, I was taught something sacred about the Geneva Conventions. Once an enemy no longer poses any threat, I was taught I owed that prisoner one half of my sandwich. And I never forgot that. That principle should apply whenever anyone enjoys a power position, dominion, and control over any other human being. Spotlighting. That's what this conference, what you, each of you, your attendance does. It does precisely that for conflict-related sexual violence. To underscore consequences and command responsibility, spotlighting is absolutely essential. In one of the later panels today, Gina Turay shared with you her work with the United Nations over a month on the ground in Central African Republic in developing guidance for mediators on addressing sexual violence in ceasefire and peace agreements. Gina explained that months of sometimes tedious research and review, hundreds of prior ceasefire and peace agreements, revealed a simple but very disheartening reality. Throughout history, sexual violence was covered, referenced, in only three of those agreements. So this research served as a starting point for action. The ceasefire agreement for the Central African Republic just last month was the most recent that the UN has helped to broker and includes the strongest language on sexual violence to this date, putting research into concrete on-the-ground practice. This is what the Peace Research Endowment, PRE, does, founded by PRIO, and we are honored to have our fearless leader, Dr. Harpingen, Christian Harpingen, here with us today from Norway. It supports peerless research and also, importantly, facilitates dialogue and partnerships carefully tailored to apply that research to the betterment of mankind. Action grounded in sound research can and does change lives, building bridges and reinforcing peace. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. And the last thing I would say to you before you go to the our reception, and thank you for coming and being here. Ladies and gentlemen, deep hope for your continuing work, your research, and the actions, the concrete actions that you deliver that lift the scourge of conflict-related sexual violence. I leave you to enjoy the balance of this inspiring conference. Thank you for letting me be here.
Thank you all. We are going to break for a lovely reception. Thank you, Pri, for sponsoring it. Thank you, Mr. Reeder, for those inspiring remarks. If there are panelists from panel 7, if you wouldn't mind visiting me down here for just a minute before you leave, and then we'll go get a nice glass of wine. And we'll see you all tomorrow, 8:30. Wonderful. Thank you. And Patty, thank you.